we have as a next speaker, we have Jeremy Larsson, who will continue the discussion and will talk about business model innovation via open APIs. He's the managing director at GrowthSmart Consulting. And yes, a lot of experience on that topic. And we will try to explore the question that Marcos in the panel this morning tried to address is like, did really we invent new business models? Did we enable new business models? We'll try to answer that with Jeremy Larsson. So are we able to have Jeremy on stage? Hello, Jeremy, how are you?
I'm great, and great to continue that particular conversation. I'll be building on a lot of what Simon said first thing this morning and Roland, and I would invite the audience to challenge and debate me around some of those questions around, are we creating new business models or is this just more of the same?
Yeah, so let's
a little bit about me. So I think probably the most pertinent things are that I've been founder GM of three consumer finance businesses. But in particular, in my last role before consulting, I was UK GM and Director of Strategic Partnerships for Currency Fair. And that involved setting up more than 10 B2B2C partnerships with major consumer fintechs like Fidor Bank in terms of them being able to use the currency exchange as a service proposition that I invented at Currency Fair. I'm also a NED of two very interesting open banking fintechs. And we'd love to talk to more about you, all of you, after the conversation. Please find me on LinkedIn. So what are we covering in this presentation? We're really expanding the earlier discussion around how open APIs, embedded finance and open banking, and the emergence of banking as a service have combined together to create disruptive fintech models. We're going to look at some key fintechs who are winning with better, easier to use and more value-adding propositions enabled by open APIs. We're going to see how you might be able to compete among the new open banking and API models and what your options are. And finally, where does the future lie? Will all of this change financial services as we know it? And we'd love to have that discussion at the end. So this is very much a recap, and some of this you'll have known before. Others, hopefully, I'll be bringing it more into greater relief. But open APIs have really transformed the way in which finance is experienced and utilized. Firstly, what open APIs and the whole open banking scene in the UK and across Europe has provided a limitless reach and access to data, and to be able to use that data to enable more opportunities for more products to more people and businesses. Secondly, it's very much about now having a single customer view. This has been talked about for more than a couple of decades, single customer view. But nowadays, with open APIs and open banking, we can see a real-time holistic view of an individual or business's financial life and record. And also, you're able to get a whole of market range of all financial products from all providers. And that will enable potentially instantaneous price and product feature comparisons as well. With that last point, that instantaneous price and product feature comparison, well, you can easily see how once you have a complete picture of a business or individual's financial needs and life stage, the ability to then combine that with that whole of market perspective to provide a matching of product price and volume, depending on what your current situation is. And also, products could be also formulated based on changing circumstances and life stages when you assimilate new data sources, for example, health data or online footprint or social. All of the above will lead to what I call a rebalancing of consumer power. So customers, as you see embedded finance and open banking and open finance develop, you'll see customers have the power to pull the right product price and volume rather than be pushed. And then finally, all of this is kind of leading down the direction of embedded finance. So where can financial services be provided and utilized at the right point of need in the right customer journey, no matter where the customer needs that financial services? So it doesn't have to be provided by a bank or a card company. It could be potentially provided by anybody. So these five, what I would call pretty much tectonic shifts, have been created as a result of open banking and open APIs. I'm not going to go through all of these use cases. There are a whole number of embedded finance and open API use cases at this point, most of which you'll know about. But I want to pick out a few. So high payroll, one from the bottom, payday advances, so salary finance being immediately available at the point of need. And they're using a range of data, including credit files, transactional banking history, as well as a predictable insight into what a customer's salary patterns are. You will have all heard of what Uber and Klarna do, but now we can provide for travel insurance instantaneous cover when booking a flight, or for freight delivery, for motor insurance, on-demand motor insurance. There is already a wave of customer propositions, and we haven't even scratched the surface. So some of you might have seen this. I can't claim to have created this particular image. This is from 11FS, the consulting group. But why I thought this was great was because it shows how the financial services value chain has been unbundled into various layers within that value chain. So you have potentially banks and non-banks providing transactional rails at the bottom, then other banks and non-banks providing certain capabilities. And right within the middle, there is what's called a banking as a service layer now. And then that's enabling non-financial services players to provide embedded journeys and embedded services with financial services. So, for example, just talking about that in more detail. So at the bottom, we have banks that provide banking as a service and non-banks. We have brands that embed finance into their offering, but we also have, most importantly, new banking as a service tech to make this all happen. This middle layer, banking as a service, is enabling new business model innovation. And there are five key components within banking as a service that I'd like to expand upon: API portals, banking platform integrators, marketplace builders, payment processing platforms, and financial data providers, each working between financial sources and then linking together amongst themselves to then be able to offer financial services through two different brands. As I said, it's got five key components, and within each of these, it's very intense. So firstly, I want to talk about API portals, and that's my phrase for this particular market. So we have players such as Kodat, Yapily itself, where Roland talked very eloquently about Yapily's position in open APIs, OpenWorks, and of course, Plaid is a major player within the API portal space. So these are the open API pipes, the AISPs, account information service providers, and the payment initiation service providers. And what they do is manipulate, assimilate, and streamline bank data for use by third parties. The second key component is what I call the banking platform integrators. And for all of those who come from established incumbent banks amongst you in the audience, I want you to have a look at what BBVA, the second biggest bank in Spain, and also one of the major banking groups in Latin America, have done in terms of creating a new business model where they've created a sort of almost like a shrink-wrapped capability for all banking as a service componentry to be able to offer that to other financial services firms or non-financial services firms who want to employ embedded finance applications. So this includes the neobank architecture, all those core banking processes stitched together. And really, this is a great illustration of where banks have seen banking as a service as a real opportunity to get involved in. So what I mean by marketplace builders, and Bud is a great example, Marketa in the United States is another great example, is where they have actually built fintech marketplaces for banks and fintechs. Bud, as you may know, have created a internal financial services supermarket for around about 3 million of HSBC and First Direct's customers in the UK. And they also combine API portal capabilities and payment processing abilities as well, which leads very neatly onto payment processing platforms, Stripe being very much the biggest one. And you'll have noted back in April this year, they entered into the treasury services market. So there's, you know, more embedded applications that Stripe are looking to develop and sell. And then lastly are the fintechs themselves. So those that are pure play product platforms, TransferWise, Wise is an example of that. CurrencyFair is another example, the firm I used to lead in the UK, where we are creating currency exchange as a service to be used by other financial platforms. So banking as a service has really got those five key components, but there's a tremendous amount of activity happening across all five. So very briefly, and I know Simon Torrance touched upon this, but I want to expand upon it in a little bit more detail. So there are some very specific strategies that I've got two axes here, the non-financial companies versus very much financial services firms and traditionalist firms versus real digital challenges. And there's four really distinct strategies here. And I want to pick out one example where BMW, amongst their fleet in Germany, have embedded car insurance at the point of need by a customer. For traditional financial services firms, I want to pick out the example of Vitality. Now, Vitality, you may know, is the life insurance brand of Prudential. Prudential, one of the oldest insurers in the UK, been going since 1843. But what was particularly innovative about them was their strategic partnership with Apple, Apple Watch, and in particular, the Apple Health app, whereby the data that is taken from the Apple Health app, one of the promotions about getting a Vitality life insurance proposition is you get a free Apple Watch. And that data then goes into factoring what your private medical insurance premiums should be the following year. So there's a real nice sort of synchronicity between the promotion, the use of the Apple Health app, and that feeding into an embedded insurance proposition. Next are all of the fintech brands that we would have known, and many of those are doing significant integrations in such a way that it is embedded both for SMEs and for customers. There are a plethora of fintech banks, neobanks, and fintech applications that are integrating, for example, with Xero. Other businesses, I've already mentioned the open API platforms, have integrations with many of the payment acceptance processing platforms as well. So there's a ton of embedded finance going in within those particular segments. And then lastly, and Roland mentioned this earlier about the rise of the super app. And this is very much a phenomenon that I think we're going to see more of in the UK as well, where we see real significant customer propositions that have wide traction. Revolut is a great example in the UK, which are looking to connect a range of different functions and capabilities within their one app. So it's not just payments, it's also currency exchange, it's also SME banking, it's also potentially corporate banking as well. And you'll see just in terms of the big tech companies like Amazon and Google, exactly what aspirations and ambitions they have in terms of the number of acquisitions they've made in that space. For example, Amazon, since 2018 alone, has made 22 acquisitions around the globe in fintech propositions that it's looking to integrate within to its marketplace. I just want to talk very briefly about a fascinating new proposition that I've seen, which really exemplifies one of the best things about open banking. So NavyPay is one of a few SME payments acceptance propositions that is both mobile first, and it's using open APIs and open banking to link to a range of different payment sources. So as I said, this is about payments being reimagined using open APIs. So Navy was built to resolve key SME pain points, and it's now pretty much the ultimate in speed, flexibility, low cost, and multi-use case. So what were some of those problems? High transaction fees. In order to accept payments, it required hardware. There were card fraud and privacy issues. Obviously, a carbon impact, given that you have a terminal and it increases the use of plastic cards. And it's not really utilizing a mobile for what it can be used for. So what was their solution? So they've developed a SME payments acceptance app using QR codes and proximity matching. It connects to all potential payment methods and sources, even crypto. It's greener and it's ultra low cost. Effectively, it's payments just done better via mobile and open banking. And what were some of those use cases? Well, mobile B2B payments, retail face-to-face payments, invoice payments, and the list goes on. So I think this is a great example of how open APIs can be used via a mobile format to really simplify and make the payments experience much easier. So moving on, what are some of the other areas that I think are really underserved where we're going to see real examples of radical new embedded finance propositions? So there's a whole range of verticals, including trade and logistics, health and wellness. I've mentioned what Vitality have done, but I think, again, we've got plenty more examples where that can be used, particularly for longevity propositions as well. So can there be more data points that can be used to tailor the right type of medical insurance or life insurance or savings proposition as you mature over life? For media, for gaming, manufacturing, supply chain, and et cetera, et cetera. And I think for horizontals, and what I mean by horizontals are potentially actually new capabilities that are being developed as a result of open banking and open APIs. Well, I've mentioned about that kind of next best action, you know, being able to identify real time what a consumer or a business's financial health is. Well, I think there will be much more intelligence applied to that holistic real-time view to be able to optimize what financial product or service is going to be required at that particular moment in time. I also think that's going to result in new propositions being, in effect, formulated as and when a customer needs it. And all those parameters of proposition can be potentially flexed. I also feel that there will be what I call customer agency models being developed, whereby actually you might have intermediaries negotiating with financial services firms on behalf of you, where you have given them agency to use your data, as well as financial life management. So I think there's a whole range of really fascinating new business models that can be developed out of open banking and open APIs. I've only got a few more slides to go, but I just want you to have a look at not just all of these global models, but in particular, I want you to have a look at India and the jumbo tail proposition. I think is fascinating, which is a proposition across the, it's around about 13 million across the whole of the subcontinent, corner shops, where jumbo tail has integrated its proposition into point of sale at the corner shop, and it provides both credit and banking to those small corner shop owners, but also to its customers as well. And I think that's just a fascinating model which I think will be extrapolated and rolled out across the world. So please do have a look at that. So lastly, where do I think financial services is going to go as a result of open APIs and open banking? Well, we're in what I call the value chain unbundling phase at the moment. So we're seeing the rise of banking as a service. We've seen real dominance of product marketplaces. But this is going to be quickly moving on. This is, in fact, where I would say we are now, where we've got very pervasive applications being introduced, where there's widespread customer and business use and adoption. So there's this thing about nascent personalization, whether it's the likes of Clio or Plum, which are using your data to provide and enable you to pull the right kind of savings proposition. There's also big tech, as I said, that's plowing a lot of resources into this space, as well as a lot of investment and acquisition. I think within less than a couple of years, you'll see this customer agency develop, so customers being in control, where there's going to be a seamless integration of embedded APIs across most B2C and B2B applications. There'll be wholesale consolidation across the industry, and you'll see what I call true finance decision optimization. And then lastly, from 2025, I think this will be just the way finance is. So there'll be integration across verticals within and across verticals, there'll be financial life management, as I'm terming it, and true customer agency. That, so this is how I see the world of financial services developing and changing radically. So lastly, this is the homework I want you to take away and think about. What's your business model innovation opportunity? What propositions could you build from open APIs and embedded finance? We haven't even scratched the surface in terms of adjacent use cases that could be used. What are customers' key financial requirements at the point of need in their journey? What new customer audiences and segments can be reached and acquired? And how could this be a key differentiator and make your business stand out? And that is the pretty much the end of my time. Capabilities, what do you need to create a new open API and embedded finance business model? More than ever, partnerships will be the strategic competency which will distinguish the winners in this ecosystem. Innovation, I think, is critical. How can you create truly new business models and proposition which leverage a customer's transaction data and digital footprint? And then lastly, competitive strategy. What will be the lower barriers to entry for offering financial products have as an impact on your business? How will that be negative and positive? How can you grow and defend against new threats? And lastly, I just wanted to leave you the Beatles, and I love this quote from Steve Jobs. My model for business is the Beatles. They were four guys that kept each other's negative tendencies in check. They complemented and balanced each other out, and the total was much greater than the sum of the parts. I think this is a great quote because this is what open finance, open banking, open APIs, embedded finance is all about. It's unlocking new opportunities for growth, new customer propositions by partnering together. Thank you very much. I'm Jeremy Larsson.
Thank you very much, Jeremy. I would add the Beatles, at least on the photo you shared, all add mustache. That was also one great reason to be successful. Let's make the mustache great again. Now, so we have some questions about the new business models. Let's say, but did you see any business model that completely reinvent a bank business model, existing business model, or not? Is it just adding new models, like how to address niche that was not possible before? Or did you see some bank moving, for example, to be just an identity provider or just an infrastructure provider or stuff like that?
So I'm not sure if I entirely understand the question, but I'll answer it in a couple of ways. So one of the great things about the direction of embedded finance enabled by open banking and open APIs is that you can have much more tailored and targeted propositions. If you are a motorbike enthusiast or a cycling enthusiast, you might be able to get very specific cycling or motorbike insurance provided by your mechanic or by your bike shop. You can definitely get more tailored propositions. The other thing is, in terms of the banks themselves, as I said, BBVA really saw an opportunity within the banking as a service space to actually be a major player and be able to almost reuse some of their existing capabilities and create a new business model out of that. So I think there is a lesson there in what BBVA did to look at your existing assets, recognize where the market is going in terms of banking as a service, and utilize those existing advantages. I'm not sure that entirely answers the question, but
That answers the question. And funny enough, BBVA also, when APIs were kind of on the rise in the banking, they also tried to make a new venture, a spin-off venture called Biva, that was an API management solutions that they tried to sell to other banks, actually as a tool provider. So that was an interesting approach. So yeah, but the goal is really to understand, like, is this just addressing new niche or addressing new opportunities on top of existing models, or if bank actually did really change that models? But even me, I don't think a bank really shifted completely the model to something new.
If I've got a bit of time, there is a kind of addendum to that question, which is, I think there are some banks which are recognizing that they might not have all the capabilities they require to really play in that space. And I really think there's three approaches that those banks are taking. The most passive, but actually not unintelligent, is what some of the banks are doing in the United States, some of the community banks like Cross River or Lincoln Savings Bank, which are renting out their regulatory capability and their license to be able to offer that to banking as a service providers and provide financial services then to third parties. So that's the most reactive, but it's actually a very smart utilization of capital. The second is exactly that. So there are some banks that are seeing banking as a service as a way to offer a lot of their capital from their balance sheets and to be able to provide the underlying financial services. And then the third approach, those are rather the capital rather. And then the third approach is some of them are actively looking at BBVA and thinking, well, we can play and operate in certain of these spaces as well. And some of those are acquiring banking as a service providers or allying or partnering with those to develop those in-house capabilities.
I think that was the perfect and complete answer of the question, Jeremy. We were really glad to have you there. Love to invite you to other conferences to continue the discussion. And thank you for exposing all this business model shift and change to the community. Thank you very much for having been with us.